Hey, welcome. In this lesson, we will be going into the details of neural networks. So we will specifically learn how the learning happens in neural networks. So the first thing that I want to show you is something that I showed you before. It is an image of a neural network and what it looks like. As I said, we have an input layer and we have an output layer. We only have one of each, and everything in between is called a hidden layer. So this network specifically has only one hidden layer, but it can have many hidden layers. And another thing to know is in neural networks, all the neurons are connected to each other. So all the neurons in the input layer is connected to all the neurons in the next layer. And all the neurons in the next layer is connected to all the neurons in the output layer in the specific one. But if there are more than one hidden layer, they're just connected to each other. So you're basically connected to only the next step. So of course we want to look into a single neuron too, right? So if this is our hidden layer or this is our input layer and output layer, they're all made of the same thing. They all have neurons. The setting of the neurons can be a little bit different, but they are just single neurons stacked together and they make a layer. So let's look into what a neuron looks like. So a neuron is basically just a calculation machine. It has some sort of function in itself, and it calculates it based on the input that is given to it. It's very simple. So let's say we have this neuron. It has two inputs, one x1, the other one is x2. And these inputs will have a weight. So this thing that I'm showing you with W is the weight. We normally call it the weight of the connection. So if we look back at our neural network, all the connections that you see here have weights. So this one, this one, this one, they all have specific weights. The input one doesn't, because this is not actually a connection. This is how I'm just showing that there's an input. And this is also how I show that there's an output. But these lines, so everything inside the network has a weight. And neurons themselves, in themselves, have biases. So these are just some values. So these are not something that we set, but these are so-called the parameters of the neural network. So this is how the learning happens. While learning something, our network gets initialized with random numbers for these weights and biases. Well, bias mostly initializes as zero, but for weights specifically, we initialize them as random numbers. And as the network sees examples, it is learning how to update these weights so that it will output the most correct thing, or at least the most accurate thing. How the output is calculated in a single neuron is like this. So we will be seeing a bunch of math in this lesson, specifically in the building blocks of deep learning, but just bear with me. It's really not that complicated. I know when it's written in this like math format, it might look a bit overwhelming, but it's actually very simple. So what we're doing here is we're saying input one, so x1 times weight one, because that's basically how it is coming inside our neuron, plus input two times weight two, because that's the weight of this input. Plus at the end, we have the bias. So we also want to include the bias of this neuron. And basically that's the output of your neuron at the end of the day. But there is one other little thing, which is this little alpha that you're seeing here. So this is not an A, this is an alpha. It signifies the activation function. So we will see more about all of this later. But here, all you need to understand is that to calculate the output of a single neuron, we multiply the inputs by the weights of the connections that they're coming from. We add the bias of the neuron, and we put all of this in an activation function. So to show you how the whole output of the whole system is calculated, of the whole network is calculated, of course, it's not only like one neuron, right? So the same thing, this calculation happens in each of these neurons except the input one, of course. So what happens is we have a weight for the first one. So that's weight one, right? We have the weight for the second one that is going to the first hidden layer neuron. And then we have another one. So basically this is how it goes. We have weight one, weight two, weight three. You can go further. And we also have biases per neuron in the network. So to calculate the output of the whole network, you're going to have to calculate this value for every single neuron. So this is a very simple looking neuron network that we have in front of us. But of course, it can get many, many, many layers deep. But just as an example, let's show you how we can actually calculate the output. So as I said, what we do is we say x1 is coming here, x1 times its weight, x2 times its weight, and we also want to add the bias. And this thing, this intermediary output that we have, is mostly called z in some sources. But you know, we're not going to use it much, but just to show you that when we only multiply the weights with the inputs and add the bias, then we have a variable called z. I would also like to get your attention to the notation here. So when we have these ones or twos or threes, this does not signify the layer number, but it signifies basically starting from the top, we just start naming them one, two, three. So, you know, this is the first neuron. So this is bias one, bias two, bias three, bias four. But for weights, it goes by connection. So the first neuron gets the first connection and then the second connection. These are called one and two. The second one gets the third and the fourth connection. That's why these are called three and four. But anyways, let's keep going. So we have the Z, the intermediary output, and then we put it in an activation function, and that's our output. So this is a proper A. So you can see that they look a little bit different because this is alpha, that signifies the activation function. This is just A. This is the variable name that we have. And this is called A1 because that is the output that we're going to send from this neuron that is highlighted here to the output layer. When we do it for all of them, this is what we have at the end. So for A2, which is for this connection, we calculate it like this. For A2, we calculate it as I've seen here. And A3, same thing. A4, same thing. One thing that you need to understand here is that, as I said, they all get X1 and X2 as inputs. You can see here. But the weights and biases are different. So for each neuron, we have the different bias. And for each connection, you also have different weights. So the first one gets weight one and weight two. The second one gets weight three and weight four, weight five and weight six, and seven and eight, as you can see. I didn't put all of them in this network to not make it super busy, but I hope you can follow also this way. So as I said, when we only calculate this input that's inside the intermediary input, then it's Z1. When we have the whole thing, it's A1. And same for all of the other ones. So this will be Z2 and A2, Z3 and A3. All right, so as I said, when we have this network, this looks very simple, right? You can even make these calculations by hand. But one thing that makes neural networks very fast is that we use vectorization. So what we do is, instead of making all of these calculations one by one, we put everything in a matrix, and then we do matrix calculations so that all of this is for the same layer is calculated instantly at the same time, instead of doing this first and doing this line for a second and the third and the fourth. We just calculate them all at the same time. And how we do it is we create a weights matrix. So we put all the weights here. You might see that this is a transpose of this matrix, because if we put them in a normal matrix, then it would be weight one and weight two under each other, and then weight three and weight four under each other. Transpose means that you're turning your matrix 90 degrees. So I just specifically put this one here like this too, because if you see it outside somewhere else, you are not confused. And then we have the biases in a matrix. Then we have our inputs in a matrix. And this is how we're going to calculate them. So as you see, it's actually the same again. We have the weight times the input plus the bias, and we put all of them in an activation function. But we do not do it a bunch of times when we have different inputs or different connections, because they're all in the same vector. So one other thing that you should pay attention here is that, of course, the dimensions of these vectors are going to change based on the network that you have. So here we have two inputs, one hidden layer, and that hidden layer has four neurons And that's why this is how we're calculating it. If we had 5 neurons, this matrix of the weights would be a bit longer. Same with the bias. Or if we had only one input, then we would only have x1 in here. So if you are familiar with matrix multiplication and summation, I would really suggest you stop the video right here and try to just work out what we have here, these vectors, and put them in this formula and just calculate them. And then we will be able to see if it's going to be the same as what we've seen before of how the forward pass is calculated or not. So if you know how to do that, stop the video right now and do it so that you can really understand how everything's working. But if not, I will walk you through it. So I'll give you a chance to pause the video. All right, so let's see how it's actually calculated. The first bit that we want to do is this bit where we are multiplying the weights with inputs. If you've never seen matrix multiplication before, so this is how you do it. You first take the first value of the top line and then the first value of the matrix that you're multiplying with, and then put them where they belong. So basically the first row of the first column. And then you do the same with the next guys. And then, because we're moving to the second line of the first matrix, we move down. So we multiply weight 3 with x1, and then weight 4 with x2. And then we keep going in this manner, and at the end, this is what we have. But as I said, this is only this part. What we do next is add the biases, but because this is an addition or is a summation, it's basically very straightforward. This is exactly the same as this one. We just add the biases in there, and then this is a matrix that we have. So this is the matrix that we have. Of course, we still need to put it in an activation function. And once we do it, this is what it's going to look like. And if you remember, this is already how we said it's calculated when we are calculating the output of a certain layer. And this is what we came out with after we worked out the vectorization. So you can see they actually output the same thing. So that's why we use this one, where all the lines of the matrix can be calculated at the same time, rather than going one by one and calculating the outputs of every single neuron. This is important to know because this basically shows you how everything works in a neural network. We don't do calculations one by one, we do them in a vectorized way. And when you're studying it outside of this course, you'll probably also see how it's calculated that in a vector way. And I wouldn't want you to be confused of like, oh, why is it in a vector, or why is everything capital? Because if you realize, we have capital letters here, whereas in the previous one we had small letters. The difference is the small letters signify the one number, the one weight, whereas the capital letters signify a matrix. So that's why they look a little bit different. All right. But one thing, of course, we haven't talked about yet is the activation function. And this, it's that little alpha here. So what an activation function is, it is basically a way to make our network learn complex things. So every layer on the network has its own activation function. So this one layer will have an activation function. The output layer will also have an activation function. If you have more than one hidden layer, they can all have different activation functions, basically. And we need them because we need the non-linearity. So if you only have a linear activation, which is basically if you do not have this alpha here, and this is how you calculate the output of a certain neuron, then everything is going to be linear. And this linearity is basically going to render the whole network useless, because you will not be able to learn anything more complex than something that can be represented with a linear equation. So just to show you what I mean by linearity and non-linearity, this is a linear function, right? So whatever we give it, it's going to give it back to us. If an input is 2, we're going to put this 2 into the activation function, and then it's going to say, okay, your output is 2. So that's why it's called linear. Whereas if you use a nonlinear function, a nonlinear activation function, you're going to get a very different numbers for whatever you're putting in. So we have sigmoid, 10H, and ReLU. These are the three most popular ones out there, or three of the ones that are kind of most commonly used. But, you know, we'll see many more of them. We will have a separate section talking about activation functions and how to choose them. But generally, what they do is they take your input and they give you a very different output. So this can either be between 0 and 1, it can be minus 1 to 1, or in ReLU's case, for example, if it's anything less than 0, then you get 0. If it's anything more than 10, then it's kind of like a certain angle. So this makes our network have the ability to actually learn complex things. Because if the network only has linear activations, or it gives you whatever you give it, then at the end of the day, it is not better than a linear regression algorithm. And we're trying to make it better than a linear regression algorithm, because, right, otherwise it's not going to really help. So there are some rules to what you should choose, which activation functions you should choose. I just wrote down some of the rule of thumbs here. So we generally, we never use linear activation functions, which is this one, in the hidden layers. Because hidden layers is where the learning happens, and we want our network to be able to learn complex problems and to be able to come up with solutions to complex problems. It is generally accepted that 10H is much better than sigmoid, so you can use it instead. And ReLU is, again, a very good one. It's really commonly used. There are many variations of ReLU also. We will see some of the problems that neural networks face, or deep learning generally faces, in the next lesson. And there we're going to talk about the ReLU and the variations of ReLU and how they help us solve these problems. For the output layer, you can use a linear activation function if you want to predict real values. That's an option. But again, as I said, never for hidden layers. Then again, depending on what you want your output to be, you can decide what you want your activation function to be. So if you want it to be between 0 and 1, you should use sigmoid. If you want it to be from minus 1 to 1, then you should use 10H. But again, this is going to depend on what your problem is. So output layer activation function decision is a little bit more common sense and based on your solution. Whereas for hidden layers, there are some certain ones that will be much better for your network. In this lesson, we learned how the information flows forwards in a neural network. That was called forward propagation. And effectively, we learned how to calculate the output of each neuron, each layer, and also the network of a whole, the outcome of a whole network. In the next lesson, we will see how the information flows backwards. This will happen with a process called backpropagation using gradient descent. We will learn more of the details of this, but one thing that we need to know is that this is the process that makes the network learn, makes the network understand the patterns in the data. So without further ado, let's get into it.